Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
This past week, I believe it was Thursday. Yeah, it was Thursday. I met this young guy. I was on a job site, you know, taking care of some things, trying to get situated, prepared for a big job that we had. And when I was coming out the office, when I was coming out the building, I was going to my vehicle, and I saw this young man, about 18 years old, kind of tall guy, maybe 6'3". And he kind of flagged me down. You know, sometimes when people flag you down, you think they want some money, they want a quarter for a couple of gallons of gas or something like that. But he didn't. He just said, "Hey, excuse me, sir, do you know where the unemployment office is?" And we was downtown. I said, "I don't know." I was looking around. I said, "I didn't even know there was an unemployment office down here somewhere." And he said, "Okay, thank you, sir." So when he left, something in my spirit said, "You know what, grab that young man. He's obviously looking for a job, you know." So I had another job project we was working on later that day. And I said, "Man, where are you going now?" He said, "Well, I'm looking for an unemployment office." I said, "Okay." I said, "I'll tell you what, give me your phone number, I'm calling you around 11:30, sharp, you know." So I called him, he gave me his phone number, I called him, he answered the phone, and I said, "Hey, I got this project, you know, coming up today. I said, if you can give me a 12:30, sharp, you know, let me wait for you, I'll give you a shot." So I did. You know, he wasn't late, he beat me there. You know, he walked from, you know, his home to where I was to meet me. He walks everywhere. And that just touched me. I'm like, wow, this young brother, he's trying, he's needing something. Make a long story short, flunked out of college. He was a straight-A student in high school. He was going to Oklahoma Baptist University or something like that. And he thought that it was going to be easy, so he was on a basketball scholarship. He, you know, like I say, he failed out. And he owed his grandma some money and owed his school some money. He can't get back in until he paid that money off. But his grandma told him, she said, since you dropped out of college or flunked out, this is what I want you to do every morning. I want you to get up at 5:30 in the morning, be at my house around 6. Don't come back until 3:30 until you find a job." That's exactly what he's doing. And I'm like, man, where did he go from, you know, 6 o'clock to 3:30? I mean, there's not that much. I mean, walking, you can't look for a job that long, you know. So he just said he'd go to the day center, day center, and kind of look around, look for a job, and, you know, that's old school there, you know. Coming from, you know, got to get up at 5:30, be out of the house at 6, don't come back to 3:30. Man, his grandmother's teaching him that's going to make a man out of him real quick, because he's going to find out that that's going to get old. So I told him, I said, "You know what, God put it in my heart to just kind of work with him alongside him. I told him to meet me tomorrow morning, 7:30, he said he's going to walk wherever I told him to meet me at. And I said, "You know, I'm going to start from here. If you do good, you know, we'll see how far it goes." But his grandmother, I talked to his grandmother the other day. She said, "Don't make it easy for him." You know, kind of sound like my grandfather. My grandfather was tough like that too, you know. But he got amazed. My grandpa, I wouldn't have been in the house at 18. I would have been living somewhere, but not there. But anyway, I just want to give the young brother a shot. He's not wanting to keep encouraging him to finish school. Don't make this a way of living. You know, it's always supplemental here. You know, just pay your money up, pay grandma back, pay the school debts back, and get back to school. I try to encourage him to go to the military, you know, like the Air Force, not the Army or Navy or anything. I mean, Army or Marines, you know, the Air Force, that's probably the best thing for him, you know. He's a great young guy. I told him yesterday, he worked with me all day yesterday. I told him, I said, "When you come to work, have your pants up, tucked in, you know, clean." I said, "Eat a good breakfast, and pack your lunch, you know, because we ain't going to be going to the store and all that other stuff, you know." That's the same thing teaching my grandfather taught me. You know, I forgot my lunch maybe twice, and I didn't do it anymore. You know, that was a long day for me. So, you know, just basic things we need to teach these young teenagers. You know, and some of the stuff I think I'm probably I got some good training from my grandfather. You know, he really laid it on me. And I'm very thankful that he did that. You know, at the time I thought he was hard and wasn't understanding, and I kind of had a flashback with this young gentleman back when I was 18 years old. It was tough. I just needed somebody to show me, to show you once it's over with. You know, so, because I was so hungry back then, hey. You know, you show a person, and he's desperate, he's in a good spot right now. He's going to make it,
amen,
or he's not going to make it. And I'm just going to give him all the, you know, information that I know. I had a long talk with God before I started my company. I had this conversation with God. I said, if I have my own company, if I am in a position to encourage, not give, but encourage some people, that's exactly what I'm going to do. So, you know, sometimes I get a bad batch of people and, you know, kind of make me want to throw in the towel. But I said, you know, I can't stop, I won't stop. So that's what it is.
Amen.
That was very good. I was sitting there at the table, Michael's house, I say, he's giving that information to me. And, you know, he's sending back the guy downtown, and the guy was looking for an employment office. Marco didn't know. I didn't know what that office is. It's like this Oklahoma workforce is what the guy was looking for. And but Marco told the guy that meet me at a certain spot at a certain time. Now Marco could get in his car and say, "Where do you live? Or I'll come drive you, or let's go over to," or, you know. But I was sitting there thinking, "Well, Marco's car. Why didn't you just give a guy a ride to meet you?" Now that right there is an attitude that you call lazy. Even though it was in my mind that Marco could do that, but in a sense, Marco was putting that guy to the test to see if you're really real. And the guy had to walk, the way I perceived it, was an hour and a half to be at that location. It was 11:30?
Yeah,
11:30. He had to walk from where he was, point A to point B, an hour and a half, if he wanted to earn that income. Now, they don't teach you that this day. That's basically old school, right, Brother McClellan? That's pretty much old school. It's good. That's old school. And then when you come to do this job, be dressed properly.
That's right.
And then come with the right attitude. Now the job doesn't pay all that much money for what, but what it was doing was instilling in the young man to be ready to win. Show me you want to win.
Yeah, that's right.
And the guy is 18 years old in that area, and once he gets all of that stuff instilled in him, the preliminary stuff, then he's ready to win. And Marco always talked and said, "Hey, you think it was hard for his grandma to put him out at 5:30 in the morning and don't come back until 3? I said, the guy was at college. He had a dormitory. He had a bed. He had food, and he was going to school on a basketball scholarship. If he could mess that up, and then you come back and put him on a hard bed, and you got to get out of here about 6 o'clock and don't come back until 3:30, he'll be safe." I think Grandma did the right thing. And I said, "I don't know how to tell my son like that." But that's tough love. How many have heard of that? Tough love. And I can see that 18-year-old maybe buying Marco's company from him. I can see. Marco told me the guy goes to church. He doesn't cuss, doesn't do none of that stuff. He's a Christian guy, gets up and go to church. He just goofed up in life. And you know, sometimes I don't know if I can tie that into a message or not. I don't know. I think God would test you to see how serious you are about making it. Hallelujah. Are you really serious? Are you just talking the talk? Can you walk the walk? Can you come down the plank? I think there was a man called Abraham. God did what? Tested him. The Bible says God tested him with his word. Abraham, can you believe this? Abraham, will you do what I tell you? Will you abide by the covenant? Will you agree what I got to do, what I'm saying? Will you agree? So I think sometimes God will, and if he tested Abraham, he'll still test us who we want. Love. Do you really want it? And I, you know, in the business atmosphere, the arena that I'm in, I always hear that you can't get anything for nothing. How many really believe that? There's a price to be paid. And sometimes you don't know the price until it's presented. Can you do it? Can you take pass the test? Okay, who am I think those? Okay, I'm through preaching. That's how benediction goes. That was great. Praise God. Any other testimonies? Praise God. Before I get started. Oh, God, our brother Ethan had one. He wants to mention that. Let's run into our Bibles, if we will, into the book of 1 John. And ever since, really since I had that conversation with Marco last night, young men have been on my mind. Young men. How do we find, and I'm going to include myself in the young men, because I still have about 50 years left on earth. So how? That's 109. 109. That's not so bad. I talked with a guy over in Pryor. I've been living by faith, making it happen. I'm self-employed, but living by faith, that make it happen. You got to get out there. And I talked to a guy over in Pryor this Friday, and he owns a propane company, passed down since his grandfather. I said, oh, that's good. I was talking as though his grandfather was gone. He said, no, my grandfather's still here. He's 106. That deal, with long life would I satisfy him, popped into my head. With long life would I satisfy him and show him my salvation. So here's his granddad, his dad that saw his son and then his grandson, that son's son, running the business today. Hallelujah. So what I want to say, I say, you know what, we as young people, we've got to get it together. Glory to God. The promise of God is not for wait till you get too old to do anything and then fall in love with God. It's about loving God when you're young. Amen. And showing all that, look what the Lord is doing. Look what the Lord has done for me. And you have that testimony. You have those trophies. You can say, this is what God has done. You can look back. This is what God has done. Praise God. So the Bible says, honor the Lord in thy what? Youth. So that the old days don't draw on you and you don't even feel like getting up out of the chair. How many know that's a reality? Come on, old folks. You know, sometimes you don't even feel like it's a job just to get up off the couch. But instead of wasting those years in foolishness and all that energy on foolishness and nothing has been accomplished, no trophy set up, no score, you're keeping score, you're losing all the time. And you say, when are you starting winning? Why wait till I got about 70 years old and I turn my life over to God? You have no trophies. You have no legacies. And then as I was a week ago, 2 weeks ago, all day Saturday, the TV's all about this famous entertainer and all of that. And some people put her in heaven, some people put her in hell, some people don't know what to do with her. And then I do realize, sister, I remember that the windings, what did they say first?
Right here at Northside Christian Center.
Yes, they did.
In Oklahoma. They were the testimony singers then. Yes. And when they came back later, they acknowledged that Northside was the first place they
So it's like, God has given you these opportunities. He's given you the windows. I open up the windows of heaven for you. He'll bless your seed, your children's children. And sometimes, so the kids get a hold where they come around and get on their stage and they don't know what to do. I mean, just come out of a little place called North Tulsa and they don't know what to do, how to step on the stage of life. And I tell you, life is ready for you. It's going to throw everything it's got at you.
That's right.
you got to be ready. And there's no better foundation, no better teaching than the teaching that you can get in a church setting. Like Sister Janine was saying, I remember when she was coming out, she wouldn't go out that big when I saw her. Glory. This is going to be a very beautiful lady.
Yes.
Praise God. And you saw her testimony in her letter today, praise God. Solid ground. She come off a solid foundation. I didn't even realize that Saturday, I was supposed to have some people have ever seen the inside of what this church looked like. Some of my friends, some of your friends had never seen what a church looked like. And that's, whose fault is that? That's our fault. Yeah, that's our fault, because we're not doing what we're supposed to do to get them inside to see what the church looks like. But that's another preaching deal right there. I have to charge you on for that message. Today, I want to talk about, I think John says, young men. I'm writing to you, young men. And I think that's going to be in 1 John. Let me see. Yeah, 1 John, probably the second chapter. Verse 12. I write unto you, little children, because your sins are forgiven for his name's sake. I write unto you, fathers, because you have known him that is from the beginning. I write unto you, young men, because you have overcome the wicked one. I write unto you, little children, because you have known the Father. So he's covering the whole family. I've written unto you, fathers, because you have known him that is from the beginning. I have written unto you, young men, because you are strong, and the word of God abide in you, and you have overcome the wicked one. But before I go any further, I want you to take a note of this Proverbs 4 and 20. How can a young man clean his way? How can a young man get his path ready for achievement and for success and ready for life? How can a young man do this? Now, then the question is asked in the midst of all the sounds that a young man and all of the vision that a young man is going to observe and see. How can a young man make it? And what he's going to have to deal with. I'm not just saying not just young man, but a young person. How do a young person make it with all the challenges that they have to deal with? Okay, every young person, raise your hand. How can I make it? How can I make it? Oh, should I just surrender to the mediocrity of Social Security, Medicaid, Medicare? Well, I don't know. Sister Hill used to work for that stuff, What's all of those things? Medicaid, Medicare, Social Security, all that. Or should I just settle to know the system and know what to do on the third? Or should I find me a girlfriend that's got all of those benefits going toward her? They call them entitlements these days. Put a fancy word on it, entitlements. Girl with pregnancy, so she got the food stamps and all this and all that. So why don't I just settle for something like that and then find me a girl and then I got it going on. Well, how can a young man make it in this day and age with all that he has to deal with? And I'm sure if you turn to Proverbs 4 and 20, you saw the answer there. Anybody see it? Pay attention. Some people pay more attention to the, I know it's true, pit bulls. Walking in my neighborhood the other day, I worked from the home, it's three teenagers of that age when they should have been either in the military, in college, or somewhere. But they're walking my neighborhood street with their famous pride, with their pet possession, the pit bulls. And I said, what a sad story. That's the best they got. They're going to pay more attention to that dog than they will to the Word of God. Any other positive self-development, personal development, I see Sister Marianne in here somewhere. I need personal development. She's into all that kind of stuff. Get your mind together. Get your head on you straight so you can make it in this life. They're going to put all their investment into that kind of stuff. I said I'm going to talk to the young crowd, but there's some older crowds with those things that we put pay more attention. So the Bible says, take heed unto my word. Adhere to it. Give it strict attention. And why? I'm not even there yet, but he says why? Because it is what? Anybody still there? Life. It's life. Life to your flesh. Life to you. And healing to all your world. Flesh. Is that true, Brother Williams? Yeah, I can stand up here and tell you. I haven't had the flu in at least 20 years. Haven't had a headache. I almost don't know what it feels like. Because I dive in. I take heed to it. People look at you like you're crazy. Never been sick. I've had a long time. I told a story. How many of my kids remember I used to hunch your trash for every morning? You remember that? Anybody? I can blow the roof off. Just wake up every morning. Lord! Just get me out. Then one day, I don't have anything. But yeah, I used to do that. Something about the word of God that would actually be a healing pill to you. So how can a young man, how can a person get his way straight? It's right here. And the Apostle John says, I'm writing to you, fathers, young men, children. I'm writing to all of you because here it is, right here. And now the more we avoid it, Wednesday night, Sunday morning, Sunday school, Sunday morning service, any other time in church, opportunity for access is available, we are on another trail. Avoiding the deal that's going to get you over. How can a young man clean his way? Now this, I didn't mention that celebrity last week, but I tell you what, when you can get caught up in, and when we step out of the house at 18, 19 years old, we step onto the stage of life, and there's so many directions to go in. Where am I? The Bible says that is the world. W-O-R-L-D. The devil has something for you out here. It's a smorgasbord. Oh, wow, where should I go? Stay up all night, go to the nightclub, go to the dance, go to the this and that. All day, all night. And then there's a guy would say to Marco, I flunked out. Basketball scholarship, probably about 30 grand per year paid for. And I flunk out. What do I do now? Then you say, I think you should write a book. And tell people how you had all of those advantages and lost it. Somebody would pay attention, I think. Yeah, you had all that. Marco said he was tall. I remember you telling him he was on a basketball scholarship. Basketball scholarship. Room and board, food, all that paid for. And I couldn't handle it. How do you handle it? The Bible says, Proverbs 4:20, take heed. Pay attention to the word of God. Make your way prosperous. Make your way prosperous. I know over here on this side of town, that's a foreign word. Prosperous. But I'm going to venture to tell you that the average rate for a successful person, a pay rate, and y'all should have told me at 10:25 I was preaching today, I had one scripture going. That what is the average pay rate for a successful person today by the hour? Are you ready for this? $100. Marianne, if I said, hang with me all day today, Monday through this Sunday, how much would you charge me? She know good well she's going to charge me $100 an hour. Because that's how valuable an hour is to her.
That's
And it could be more. It could be more. It's at least $100. He said, well, wait a minute. He said a word there that kind of tripped me up. It's called value. What do you mean, value? Well, you get paid for your value. He said, well, no, I get paid $12 some cents an hour. No, yeah, that's your value. So the Bible says, how does a young person make his way? This right here will increase your what? Value. Increase your value. What are you bringing to the table? Why am I working at the grocery store? Okay. $6 an hour. Work for Marco. He's a nice guy. How much are you going to pay you? Your value for doing that. That's why he told the guy, you don't want to do this. Don't your young folks come up here and come up at me, but I'm telling you the truth. You don't want to do this. Your value for forking out of college and blowing it, here is your value. This is what you were worth. Now, if you go back to school and you get all what you learn and pick up your value, get a degree and get an expertise in this and that, guess what? Your value will do what? It'll rise. You take something to the marketplace of value, the marketplace will what? Pay you. For your value, what you bring to the place, what you bring to the table. Okay, I'm through preaching. Let's go. No, it's totally the fuck. Praise God. So, what the Bible says that the Lord takes pleasure in the prosperity of His what? Takes pleasure in it. And the question has always been and always has been: what report? What will you choose to believe? Because you're going to step out from mama's porch onto the world stage of life, and you're going to believe, and all of us are going to buy into somebody's report. And that report is going to that belief system, whatever you done went into, is going to help you determine your value. And life is not going to give you not one penny more than what you are placing a demand on for. You may want to get paid like a chief surgeon, but you better have some value like a chief surgeon. Medical internist, all that. You better bring that to the table. Or else life will pay you what you're bringing. So let's look at the word again. Like in 1 John. And I'm going to read it, start with verse 15. 1 John, what's that, 2 and 15? Yeah. 2:15, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man know the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world does what? Pass away. I've been messing around with the world for so long. Guess what now? I'm 60 years old. What happened? It passed away. It's called pseudo-prosperity. A pseudo-favorable condition, situation. I found somewhere what they call today. I found somewhere to land for the time being. I found me a comfort spot. Guess what? After a while, time has passed you by. The gray hair starts showing. I remember I used to have this little small patch right here. Now I'll be lucky to find a black spot. What happened? Time is gone. Hallelujah. And if I had not been in the Word, married to a good woman for 35, so many years like that, and getting eaten good and all that kind of good stuff, I would be gray hair and all broke down. No teeth. About that big. Yeah, mind gone. What happened? Time went on, but the world and all that was given to you passed away. Now God says through His Word that He gives His stuff is everlasting. And I believe He has done to say from generation to generation. Not going to bless you, Abraham, but I'm going to bless your seed after you. That's what God says. That's the deal he brings to the table. I'm not going to not only bless you, but I'm going to bless your seed after you. How are you going to do that, God? You're going to look at my covenant and you're going to pay attention to it. That's what he's saying. Now, there's going to be some distractions, sure enough, whether you're young or whether you're old. I personally don't watch that much television unless there's a sports show on or the news. Can't even tell you. I just can't get in. I don't even know what's on TV. It's hard for me to sit there and watch. What? He married her mama. What? That's entertainment. Oh, please. And some people sit there and watch that show after show. And the only people that's really making it good on that kind of stuff are those 1 minute commercials that come on in every 12 minute segment. That's who's getting paid. Because you're watching now. Now go buy the Bud. Here comes the Budweiser commercial. And people are going out and do what? Go buy some Budweiser. And they're wondering, why am I 350 pounds? Potato chip commercials. Why am I in bad health? Because you've been sitting there and feeding that to your mind subliminally, or just on purpose, and you're going to go out and go right to the store and buy a little bag of potato chips, or buy a Budweiser, or something like that, and then buy stuff that doesn't do you no good, and you're going to wind up in poor health and broke. Instead of sitting in front, I should have just been here. I know y'all. You should be reading a good book, a good Bible, going to church on Wednesday night. Getting fed on the word of God and let the pit bull go. You're not that valuable. So because I do know, I definitely do know that in 5, 6, 7 years, the going rate on a job has got to be close to $100 an hour, or else you're going to be in lower class income. Just think about it. $300 a day is $100,000 a year income. $300 a day. It's $100,000 a year income. Take that and divide it in half. It's $150,000 and you'll make $50,000. How many would like to have $50,000 a year? Fair enough. I have a friend of mine who tells me $50,000 a year in New York, you're on the street. But you're not on the street if you're on the system. You're on welfare and whatever is it? Food stamps, Medicaid, Medicare. I don't even know. But you're not on the street if you got that. But who wants to live like that? No, you can't have that kind of mindset because you are a child of God. He says, I'm writing to you because you are overcomers. Somewhere in this chapter, he says, you are overcomers. In other words, you are better than that. Yes. You can do it. It's in you. It says you have the auction from the Holy One. That he's not settling for mediocrity. He wants to show that you are a winner, and not only do you win, but you more than triumph. The Bible says that God gives us this word and these promises to show that he is upright. He always comes through. He always delivers. He always sets us up on a high place. Gives us a large field to run on. That's what the Bible says. That's what kind of God that you have. But if we grow up as young people and we want to conform to the world. Now, I am not one of them hard preachers and all that. But I remember the guy named Elder Crump back in the day. Some of y'all don't know him. My Sister Hill may still remember him. Oh, he'll run half of us out of here this morning. Woo! And now today's day, when you got tattoos, ink all over you, he'll have a heart attack trying to preach to folks. We say that he was hard. Hard. We say after he leave out of here and church be dismissing, we'll be out there, boy, He's hard. He's hard. I'm going to tell you something. And some of that stuff that he was preaching, that's why I'm still here today. Oh, yeah. It's heaven or hell. I don't even remember that. Lot's wife. We got getting up at 5:30 in the morning. It's hard. Take this. Don't look back. Leave your family. Leave your home. Don't you look back. Lot's wife. She looked back. Pull us off. Oh, boy. Sometimes it takes that kind of preaching. Pastor Doug mentioned it the other day that nobody talks about hell. It messes up your crowd. Messes with your offering. But this same book, 1 John, he tells you who makes it in and who don't make it in. I'm writing to you little young ones, I'm writing to your children, I'm writing to your fathers, I'm writing to you. I'm writing to all of y'all, and here it is. He tells you who makes it in, who don't make it in. It's clear, but we don't preach it that way. It's not, you don't get enough offerings on that kind of preaching. Glory to God. Let me preach just a little bit more. Let's go into chapter 3, verse 13. And let me just finish up with verse 24 in chapter 2. He says this in verse 24, chapter 2. Let that therefore abide in you, which he is saying the word. Let the word stay in you, which you have heard from the beginning. If that which you have heard from the beginning shall remain in you, you also shall continue in the Son and in the Father. So the word, the holy word that you have gotten from your childhood up, if you keep it, you're going to do okay. Verse 26, it says, these things have I written unto you concerning them that seduce you. And this is amazing. This is what happens. It can happen to anybody. You got seduced. You got hoodwinked. Paul calls it bewitched. Who put some magic on you? What happened to you? You was walking in faith. Now you're walking in the flesh. Now you're not in faith. What happened to you? And that can happen to anybody, praise God. So we jump over to the third chapter and verse 13. It says, marvel not, my brethren, if the world hate you. You know that you have passed from death unto life because you love the brethren. He that loveth not his brother abideth in death. Whosoever hate his brother is a murderer. And you know that what? No murderer. See, that's not Williams, that's the word. No murderer. Got life in him. Not only life, but he'll have eternal life. Okay. Glory to God. So I'm just about out of here. Praise the Lord. Oh, hallelujah. Now, for the believer, if you can jump over to Isaiah 53, the question pops out. Centuries way ago, the question pops out. Whose report are you going to believe? Glory to God. Is the world or is the word? And it's a simple choice. You don't have a whole bunch. Not really a multiple choice. It's just one or the other. Joshua said, for me and my house, we're going to do what? We're going to serve the Lord. That's where we draw our line in the sand. Many people today are running around, they haven't drawn their line in the sand. You don't know where they are. So many people that come to church. And let me say it like this. How many would think that people come to church completely sober? In other words, no influence of drugs, alcohol in their system. They're just ready to hear from the Lord. Oh boy, some folks come into the Lord's house hiding the kites, Sister Hood. Church folks, hiding the kite. Now, whose report are you going to believe? And John, I think it says back in Joshua's day and Moses' day, God says, I'm going to put it before you, and you make a choice. And the question is, how can a young man make his way good? How? Okay, that's one question. How can, then it says over here, whose report are you going to believe? Whose system are you going to buy into? Does the world and all of his fanfare, all the great looking stuff it's got for you, when the Bible tells you it's temporary and it'll pass away and it'll leave you shameless, naked in a bathtub, dead from an overdose? And that celebrity of the last week or so wasn't the only one. It won't be the only one. There's so many unknowns. Whose report? Verse 50, chapter 53, verse 1. Whose report? Who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? Who knows the grace? Who knows the mercy? Who knows what God can do for them? Who knows this? If you knew God, you know God has saved you. You know God has made a way for you when you had no money, no nothing in your favor. You knew it was God that came through for you when you were at your worst moment. Who has seen the arm, the goodness, the love, the kindness of the Lord? And whose report are you going to buy into? So that's what he's saying here. And he says, well, this is what's happened for you. Somebody grew up. Here you are, a man, a woman, trying to make it, trying to take steps. The word is saying somebody grew up as a young person and took the same steps you're walking in. Same thing. All day, he didn't see. See, some people think that, well, you can't make a mistake when you're growing up. No, this guy, he walked. But he says, not the sin. Should have went to college, but I decided to go get a job. Bad choice out of high school. They're going to pay you your value. Wasn't very many people like me out of high school, but I had people come knocking on my door trying to get me to go to work for them. I'm talking about airlines to communications. When me and Candy got married, I had the house, I had the furniture, I had the car, I had the health insurance, I had it all. 23, how old was I? 23. I can't say I was a dummy in school, but I was a pretty sharp guy. Me and my dad in my living room trying to make a choice. Who are you going to go to work for? I don't know. I drove those recruiters crazy, Sister Hill. But I'm telling you, where is the prep? When am I ready for life? Ever since then, 1971, I've been in, out of a job, in, out of a job. I'll tell you one place I've never been in the world for. I was stupid enough to tell Sister Denise, Sister Denise, by the time I'm 40, I'll be a millionaire. She's stupid enough to believe it. And so she can tell you is that he never backed off his testimony. One thing you know, the guy is staying on his line. Glory to God. I can get up out of my house one day now and go call him a place, and I can come back with thousands of dollars. Self-unemployed. I haven't made it to the millionaire status, but I'm knocking on that door. One door I will not knock on is the door of poverty. As a young man, I said, no, that's not enough. $300 a week is not enough for me in a day, let alone a week. I don't want no job benefit. What do you call that? Unemployment benefit? No, I'm going to make my way, and it's going to be more than $300 a week. Now, that sounds like a lot of money to some people. I'm like, where did you shrink your mind down to think that was some money? ONG's going to send you a bill for $100. Or more. PSO's coming right behind them. city of Tulsa, not too far behind. And you guess what? If you don't show, they come with the cutoff key. Kids in the house or not. Where, how can a young man do what? Make his way. Make his way. So whose report are you going to believe? You're going to believe the world system, or are you going to believe what the Bible says? Take heed, pay attention to my word, for here's the life and here's the health to all your flesh. Ooh. Maybe I would charge for this, sister. Okay. Okay. He should grow up. Here's someone walking in your steps. He should grow up. He should grow up. As a root out of a dry ground, he had no form of comeliness, and when we should see him, there's no beauty that we should desire of him. This is not a guy born with a silver spoon in his mouth. He's despised. He's rejected, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. We esteem him not. We don't have much to do with this guy. Who is this guy? But he's experiencing everything that you will experience in life, except for the sin. The defeats. You mean he was defeated? Yeah, he was defeated on the earth. Wow. Hung on a cross, naked, exposed to the world, beat up so that you couldn't recognize him. He's defeated on the earth. But it took that defeat in order to help you out, you and me out. If he's not defeated in life, you and I can't win in life. So he took the defeat on our behalf. Then he said, it goes down into the grave. You know what he said? I lose because I choose to lose. I gotta lose to help everybody else out. But then who is this revealed to? Only people that can come out on Wednesday nights and Mondays and study the Bible, they can see this. This man took the defeat for me. I don't have to settle for defeat. He took it. Not only that, but he went down to the ground. And he paid the price for my sins. It took him 3 days to satisfy that claim. So when I'm walking the earth, I'm not going to walk around in defeat of sin. I'm not going to have a mental attitude that says, my value is so low. Your value is so high. It's already been demonstrated that he died for you. Well, I don't know how great I am. Then you need to read this word. I guarantee you, in your quiet hour, it's going to come to you. I'm worth more than this. I've had enough of this. Minimum mediocrity, I've had enough. And the thing about it is that you get that revelation before your spouse does. Your spouse might get him to get rid of you. He's not worth much. He had me fooled. He gonna see, he gonna know it's my hand. Look what he's bringing to me. Oh. So it's important that you get that revelation. Who says, what is my value? What am I bringing? Hallelujah. I'm going to get ready to close out here in just a minute, praise God. Surely, verse 4, he bore our griefs, carried our sorrows, esteemed him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are what? Healed. You can't get 10% of the church world or Christian world to say that with conviction. By his stripes, I am healed. You come off the deathbed when you make that kind of proclamation. By his stripes, I am healed. What is that? That's going against all type of opposition. But it's true. It's reality. And when you believe it in your heart and say it with your mouth, it dissolves everything. Contrary to God's perfect will for you and your life. By his stripes, I am healed. The devil and the other crowd said, be quiet. You can't be saying stuff like that. Let them put a needle in you. Let them put the IV in them. Let them put you on life support. How can I find my way? The Bible says, take heed to the word of God, for it is life in it and its health to all of your flesh. But whose report do you believe? I can go with the world and its system and all the glamour and glitter that it has. I can get my prized possession, my pit bulls, and walk down the street with my pants sagging and not a bath in 3 or 4 days. And I got it going on. I can find me a girl who likes that. You don't believe it? They can find a girl that likes that. Then it's going to be, who comes to the realization first that somebody's got better value than this? I'm going to close out. I hate to sound so secular. I was looking at, how many know, I know Sister Mary and knew Mary Kay? Heard of Mary Kay? How many have seen her mansion down in Dallas, in Texas? It's now on the auction block. And it was selling for $3.6 million. Mary Kay is long dead. Somebody else is in right now, but they got enough to see. Then my computer had nerve enough to have on the side a link to say, look at other houses for $2 million, $1 million, and see what the mortgages would be on a 30-year note for those houses, if you like what you see. So of course, I'm going to click on them. I clicked on one for me in the house. Wow, that is great. 6 bedrooms, 4-car garage, all this and all that. $1.6 million. And you look down and it says, monthly mortgage for 30 years, $3,000. $3,000. So still can afford that. $3,000 a month. Not bad. That's not, I mean, that's really doable. If you was hungry enough, you really wanted that enough, you could do $3,000 a month. And you're not guilty. What if that's a little bit too much? $1 million house? What if you drop it down to a $500,000 house? $3,000? Down by half? About $1,000, $1,500 maybe? $1,700 a month for a house? Maybe anybody living like that? But not if you're in the world for a while, you can't see that. If you're on the Medicaid, Medicare, and all that, you can't see that. How can a young man get there? Clean up his way, read the Word of God, pay attention to it. $1,700 a month, quite doable. How many around here pay $700 for a shack? Per month. I got a friend who offered me 3 houses. He says, I've got $700, $725, $750. For all 3 of them, I got rentals in them. You want in? I backed it over. I said, well, somebody's paying $750 a month, surely. Just think about how close they are to $1,500 for a $500,000 house. At today's interest rates. See, now you got me into secular preaching now, because I want to pass my time. But it says, let this mind, Romans 12 and 1, I beseech you, he says, renew your mind. Or I can see David the king living at $700 a month. Oh no, I can't. I can't see all those famous people. Joseph, he came out and ran Egypt. Daniel, he came out and ran, did the stuff with Pharaoh. God raised them up. So I'm saying today, people. The world has showed you your value, and just less than what's in here, you need to drop the world. The world has showed you your value, and it doesn't measure up to this. If you've been doing something for a number of years, it's time to make a change. Or else time will go right by and you'll be a gray hair, no teeth, that big, and you'll wonder what happened. Glory to God. So the devil, I think the Bible calls it slumber, sleep, slept right through it. Not in a hole, you can't even get up out of the chair. It's a struggle to get up. Honor the Lord in your youth while you are strong. So that the Lord is active. You got that function. You got it going on while you are young and strong. Don't wait till the years draw and you say, I have no pleasure in them. Come on. Brother Dean. Well, let's stand. Let's have some kind of prayer. Let's recognize. Let's count the score. See where I am. Glory to God. That's not where I am. I'm going to raise my value. The birds have to fly south in the wintertime. They can't change their direction. If it's bad down there, they still got to go. You and I, we're not animals. We can change the course that we're on. Glory to God. Why? Because God made us that way. We can change. The guy that dropped out of school that Mark dealing with Marco, he can change. He can stop getting up at 5:30, but he's got to show some difference. Got to show something. Bring some value. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Call by his name. Call upon the name of the Lord. Call to be saints. Hallelujah. Glory. The Lord takes pleasure in the prosperity, in the good living of his people. He takes pleasure. Nothing's too hard. Place my feet on the high places of the earth. Take me to the edge and I don't fall off. Hallelujah. Make my feet like hinds feet. Hallelujah. Glory. Let me soar like an eagle. Fly around. No distress. Nothing bothers me. Let the wind blow. Hallelujah. I just set my wings out and rise above it all. Hallelujah. Nothing's too hard for God. Nothing's difficult for him. Hallelujah. But beloved, above all things, I want you to do well and prosper and be in health, even as your soul does prosper. That same writer, that's what he says, beloved, above all things, I want you to do well in life. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Father, we thank you for Jesus making that sacrifice. Hallelujah. That offering to sin. We thank you that he did redeem us, the complete atonement. We don't have to settle. Hallelujah. We can look to him. Hallelujah. High above the heavens. We're seated with him in heavenly places. We give you all the praise and glory. Hallelujah. We don't walk around sick. We don't dwell on it. We don't accept it. We stand against it. Sickness, poverty, and disease. Anything contrary to your will, we stand against it by your word. Hallelujah. So bless all your people, Father. Open up our minds. Hallelujah. Show us revelation. Give us knowledge. Show us your way. Pass all of the other things on the stage of life. Let us see Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. We give you all the praise and glory. No matter what age, but you say age upon age, time without end, from one generation to the next generation. We thank you, Father, for being our God. Give you all the praise and glory in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. If you have a special prayer request, the Bible says if there's any sick, call for the elders, let them pray. Hallelujah. Lord, if there's any distress, and they're not going your way, this is